All right, so let's spend some time trying to get a better understanding of where this formula is coming from. You can use it right now on your calculator in the TI-84. I've shown that in a previous video, but you know, let's see how we can work with this. If you want to get a brief example in a short few minutes as to how you would use binomial PDF, then take a look at one of the earlier videos. So let's see if we can talk about this for a few minutes. Remember in one of the earlier discussions, we talked about the event of having several different individuals, A, B, C, D, and E. We gave them names: Al, Bob, Charles, David, Edward, and they were going to run for office. And what we said is, what we looked at is that one is going to be the president, one is going to be the VP. And what we wanted to know is how many different ways could they fill those two seats. And so there was an easy, more or less easy way to look at it, given that you may have only five choices for filling those seats, A, B, C, D, and E. That first seat then represented choosing one as president, and then the second one, we're only left with those four options. Since A was chosen, what we're left with is B, C, D, and E, those four options. And if B is chosen as the president, the options after that would be A, C, D, and E, and so forth. Each one of those would have four options. So you have five here, four here, 5 times 4 is 20. Since there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 groups of four. If you wanted to enumerate or list those different groupings, that first one would be AB, the second one AC, the third one AD, AE, BA, BC, and so forth until you get all the way down to the bottom. ABCD, that last might be EA, EB, EC, and ED. And you'd get a list of all 20 possible ways you can choose two to be a president out of those five individuals. But instead of president and vice president, let's give these two positions another title, right? We said president and vice president, so those two positions indicate station in some sense, meaning that these two, as president and vice president, is different than these two. If we said order doesn't matter, instead of 5 times 4 equals 20, what we'd end up with is 5 times 4 divided by 2 factorial, which would be a 10. We'd end up with 10 different options because we wouldn't have to count both A and B separately. So now, instead of president and vice president, let's give these two positions a different title. Instead of president and vice president, let's call them maybe, let's say, Guru 1 and Guru 2. Or so those are the two seats that are being filled, Guru 1 and Guru 2. So how many ways can these seats be filled by those five members? Well, nothing has really changed. We'd still have the same kind of enumeration. We've just changed the title. So given that nothing has changed, the number of groupings stays the same, even if we change the title from president and vice president to Wise Guru 1 and Wise Guru 2. The number of combinations would still be 5 times 4. And if those two gurus are equivalent in power, then it's actually going to be not 5, just simply 5 times 4, but 5 times 4/2, right? Instead of permutations, then we're looking at combinations, and we'd have 10 different combinations. So now let's see if we can connect this to binomial probability distribution functions. So we called those seats that were being filled initially president and vice president, then guru one and guru two. What I'm going to do is kind of change the way that we're thinking about this. If those seats turn its occupants, right, into girls, how does this change the math? Right, so given that we have A, B, C, D, and E, we have those 5 individuals. Only 2 of those at any time can be in that seat. We're going to call those seats, we're going to say that those are the seats in which girls reside. So how many ways can we get 2 girls is really what we're looking to answer. Right, how many ways can we get girl 1 and girl 2? And that's what those seats represent when we choose those. Whoever sits in those positions will automatically be changed into a girl. And so I'm just trying to change the language a little bit. So instead of guru 1 and guru 2, I'm going to use the G1 and G2 and think about this in terms of this magic changing of girls to see if this changes the math. So you wouldn't expect it to, and it won't. But this gives us a nice segue into, hopefully a nice segue into thinking about a broader sense of how to work problems like this. So how many ways can we turn those 2 seat holders into girls? Well, it's the same question that we've been answering. Given that you have 5 different individuals, how many ways can we put them into these 2 positions, girl 1 and girl 2? And if we say that order doesn't matter, then we're looking at combinations. So this would give us NPR divided by R factorial, which would be choosing 2 of them. And so 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1 all over 2 factorial would give us 60 different ways. 5, you know, given that we have 5 members, 50 different ways we can end up with 2 of those individuals magically turning into, or not so magically, but turning into girls. So we're kind of assuming that it's all men, all boys at this point. So let's see, what if we take this a little bit further? Given that we have N equals 10 members, right? Now we have 10. If what we did worked with 5, let's see if it makes sense to generalize this to 10. So the question remains, how many ways can we magically, right? And the random event is similar to this in that this happens. It's random, it's unpredictable. How many ways can we magically turn those who sit into those, who sit in those 2 seats? How many ways can we end up, how many individuals can we place in those seats and end up turning those 3 seats? Into girls, right? And again, order doesn't count. So if we follow the pattern that we've seen before, we know that it's going to be 10 choose 3, which is, right, it's coming from the NPR of R factorial. So that number, right, we could calculate rather easily That number would be 10 times 9 times 8 all over 3 factorial. And that 3 factorial is 3 times 2 times 1. And if we do the math on that, we would see that what this gives us is 30 times 4, or 120 different ways, given 10 members in the club, that that we could get those 3 seats to magically turn into girls. So girl 1, girl 2, girl 3. So what would that look like? What are those scenarios? If we kind of do the enumeration on this, we're looking at something that looks like this, right? We have 10 members in the club, and it would go something like number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way out through member 10. And so A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. So J would be the last member of the club, John. A, B, C, D, E. There are 10 different ways that we can choose the first member that who gets placed into that seat, right, who's turned into G1. And then once we've chosen that, we still have 1, 2, 3. Since A was chosen, we have B, C, D, all the way down to J is where we would stop. So at that point, instead of 10, we have 9. And then with the last choice, instead of A and B, we would be able to choose either. Since A is chosen, we have C, D, E, all the way down to J. So that last one would be an 8, 8 different options. So we're looking at groupings that look like this: ABC, ABD, ABE, AB, F through J, and so on. We'd continue on. And we'd have 120 different combinations. So if those are the 3 that are magically converted to gurus or girls, what it means is that the others are all not part of that grouping. Those would all be boys. So let's think about this. We have 120 of those. The first one would be of those sets, that complete set, A, B, and C. And then the second, third, and fourth, A, B, and D, A, B, and E, A, B, and F. And then, so those are those 3 that would be chosen and turned into girls. But then we'd have 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 of these, right? And 7 boys here. So we're looking at 3 gurus, or 3 girls and 7 boys. And the total number of possibilities for these different groupings would be NCR, which we know to be 120. So there are 120 different ways that we can choose 3 girls, or magically turn 3 individuals into girls out of the 10. Now, each one of those events event 1, event 2, event 3, event 4. Each one of those has a certain probability of occurring. Remember the multiplication rule. The probability of event A, probability of having a girl, or magically turning one someone into a girl, and turning the next one into a girl, and turning the next one into a girl, and having the next three, or the next seven rather, be boys. We can figure out that probability for this scenario. And in fact, we know that since each one of those probabilities of having a girl, let's say that it is 0.52. So 0.52 times 0.52 times 0.52 repeated factors. So I'll just use my short term and my shorthand and call it 0.52 cubed. And then the next one, probability of having a boy is going to be the opposite of the probability of having a girl. So 1 minus 0.52, which is 0.48. So that's 0.48 right there. And the number of those would be 7. That in general would look something like this. If we keep it less specific, the probability of having a girl times the number of magical seats, or the number of successes, R, times the opposite of that, 1 minus that, which would be the probability of having a boy. If we have 3 girls out of the 10 kids, the others, right, all of the others, n minus r, which would be something like 10 minus the 7, n minus r would be the number of boys. So once we know r and n, we automatically know n minus r, meaning that if we know that we have 10 boys and we're interested in, or 10 kids, if we know that we're interested in looking at 3, r is equal to 3, girls, for example, we know that the rest have to be boys. And that's certainly always going to be the case with binomial events or Bernoulli trials, where it can be only one or the other. It's only going to be one or the other. So this is kind of, well, this is the more general expression. Sometimes you'll see the probability of having, or the opposite of a probability being referred to as something like this, PQ, where P and Q are complementary, and Q is just 1 minus P. That's not uncommon at all, and you'll see that on a number of occasions. Now let's finish this. We know that this is the probability for event 1 happening. We know that that also is the case for event 2, event 3, event 4, event 5. As we go down this list, each of those will have the same probability. Since we're looking at those first 3 seats, really representing the same scenario, 3 girls, with the others being boys. So how many of these do I have? Well, we know that it's, we've seen that that's going to be NCR combinations. And then finish this up, it's going to be the probability. How many of those NCR times the probability of having a girl times the to the third power, or to the number of successes, times the probability of having a boy, which is 1 minus PG, which would be a 7. So, number of successes, number of not necessarily a failure, but, you know, not the event that we're interested in. If we do the math on this, we have 120 times 0.52 cubed times 0.48 to the 7th. So on our calculator, let's go back and look at this. 120 NCR times 0.52 cubed times 0.48 to the 7th. So it's 120 times 0.52 cubed times 1 minus that, which would be the 0.48, the probability of having a boy, to the power of 7. So that's just one row of our a number of scenarios. Of our 120 different scenarios. And so when we, you know, the 0.52 cubed times 0.42 7th is just the, to the 7th is just one of the 120 probability. So multiply by 120, and what we get is 0.099. So 9.9% chance that given you could have 10 kids, the probability of having exactly 3 girls would be the 9.9%. So it's a little bit clumsy doing this formula where we had to drop in these values. There's a formula on your calculator that's going to make that a little bit easier for us. So instead of having to kind of go through this process where we have to use this formula, if you look here, notice that really there's 1, 2, 3 things that need to be dropped in. Right, as long as we know the probability of a success, the number of successes we're interested in, which would be R, and then finally the number of trials, or the number of attempts, which would be N, we should be able to calculate the probability of having exactly R successes. Well, instead of having to do that each time, your calculator allows you to use binomial probability distribution function, binome PDF, not binome CDF, which would give us a particular sum that we'll see later, but the probability of one particular event occurring, the probability of having exactly, in this case, it's the probability of having exactly three girls. So binome PDF requires that you put in the number of trials, P, the number or the probability of a success, and R, the number of successes. And by putting in those three values, right, it allows us to calculate the probability of exactly some number of successes for some number of trials. So N is the number of trials. P equals the probability of a success. successes we're interested in. So if we drop those numbers in, it would look something like this: binome, PDF, the number of trials. We would have 10 kids, or 10 free throws attempted, and then the probability of a success, depending on who's shooting the free throws, or depending on some other statistics that we've gathered over time that might tell us the probability of successfully having, or the probability of having a girl. Let's say that that's 0.52. That's what we've been working with. And then the number of successes, if we're interested in looking at the probability of having exactly 3 successes. We'd put that in there. And when you punch that into your calculator, you'll get the same number that we got here. So let's put that in quickly. Go into second. Alright, that's red. And then we're going to look at distribution. Second vars, or the DISTR distributions. So let me do that again. Second distribution. And then you're going to move the cursor until you get to binomial PDF. Not C, but PDF. We'll select that one. The number of trials is 10. Probability of a success is 0.52. And we're looking at exactly 3 successes. We're having 3 girls. So X value is 3. And when you put that in there, we end up with, a typo. Let's do that again. Second entry. And we're going to clear this. And second distribution. There was an X in front of my binomial PDF that contained a value, so it served as a multiplier. So I'm going to just do that again and let it run. And we get the 0.099. And if you recall, first way we did it, the long way, we also got 0.099. So binomial PDF allows us to simplify our data entry and make fewer mistakes.